for what you want the ratio to be, and then those principles can have, policies that can change as the technology evolves. Because that then means that if tomorrow, you know, we have different technology that has evolved, we still have common principles around, you know, how to protect trust, how to protect people that are going to be using these currencies, but we have not prescribed to a level where we need to change the act every time technology changes, as I think it might be necessary for our national payments bill already to think about whether we need to broaden the definitions. Thanks.
The fact that there is no legal regime, does that make what Noah is talking about illegal?
So I used to take an approach in my father's house where I'd say, my father hasn't expressly said no, he has implied a yes. And so when it comes to technologies, digital money for example, I think that to the extent that you do not have a law that says no, it becomes open to accept them in society. Because remember, they are not the type where you're going to say you cannot bring in Kenya shillings across the border. That the technology, you know, the currency that we're dealing with is of a nature that it can cross borders comfortably. Now the issue then becomes how we try and ensure that while it's operating in Uganda, absent of a legal regime, we can still have the necessary protections for the people. I think one of the challenges that we've had is that different groups of people think about digital money very differently. So there are people who think about digital money and who think just mobile money. And there are people who think digital money and think just cryptocurrency. And we've all seen in the papers in the past couple of months about people who've lost money in cryptocurrency. It's open to discussion whether they've lost money in cryptocurrency or they've lost money in, you know, as a result of not knowing exactly what is involved in cryptocurrency, and therefore when a person comes and tells them that they are going to become rich, they just need to pay a certain amount monthly, you know, they can believe it. And that's where the question, I suppose, of regulation comes in, is that absent regulation, what do we do? I think it's not that it's prohibited, because the nature of this technology is that we cannot prevent it's happening in society at the moment, but it is that we just now need to take the steps, and I suppose EDS will be, you know, happy to have a conversation on how do we now take the steps around crafting the necessary regulatory regime.
Thank you, Lori. We ask EDS to take us through the steps. I think that's a very good transition here. EDS, these things that we're talking about are not yet clearly defined within the existing laws, like we were just being told. And the central bank is our custodian of trust on the economy. Now, how is the central bank prepared for this next phase of the digital economy, for this next phase of digital money? How ready are we as a central bank, and what needs to be done from your perspective, sir?
What needs to be done? I think before we even get into that, we need to first, at least from a central bank point of view, understand what digital money is and what it's not. If we go to the tradition of definition of money, and I know they have attempted, money normally has three characteristics. It's a unit of account, it's a store of value, it's a medium of exchange. Yeah? On those three parts are all these things that we refer to as digital money, the tokens, cryptocurrencies, e-money. Are they money? Because if they are, then we think of regulating them as money. For some, they would pick off two of the three, others one of the three. So then the next question that the central bank we ask is, if it's not money, but acts like money, what do you do with it? And like I said earlier on when I was introducing myself, my job is to work. There's a reason why I have no hair on my head. And a missing tooth. So, that point, the central bank has been, you know, having constituted personalities, we need to ask ourselves, if at least we don't know, don't we appreciate what is not this money or not, can then we then turn around and focus and say, okay, in its application or in its use, what are the risks associated with it? So if I don't know what it is, at least let me understand the risks associated with it. I might not be able to define it. If I ask anyone in this room here for a simple question, what is that? You can describe it, you can feel it, you can even feel its effects on you, or believe its effects on you. But you can't really define what time is. So that's the same dilemma or conversation we have in the central bank. Obviously, there are potential use cases, there are benefits, just as well as their costs. So we focus on the risks now. What Bank of Uganda has done in partnership with a couple of other agencies is we are creating something called a regulatory sandbox. What essentially this means is my friend the lawyer said, there is no regulation. We agree. We can't possibly even try to write regulation for technology because the technology moves faster than our parliament works. So, what you do in the regulatory sandbox, you define a broad framework and say, if you want to try something for which we don't have a regulation, let us sit with you as Bank of Uganda. You have a pilot of this product or asset or service that you want to provide, whether it's for payments, whether it's for savings, whether it's for insurance. In that environment, we are going to say a 6-month period. In that period, in that pilot phase, our focus is on understanding the risks. Now, not just only from your viewpoint as the potential operator, but from a viewpoint of as a regulator or someone who is by law mandated to protect potential consumers of your service or product. 6 months down the road, we expect to have identified the risks that within reasonable means. Because in life, there are always those unknown unknowns, the things you don't know that you don't know. So we focus on those that we have managed to find. And our question to you, as the person who is participating within this regulatory sandbox, is what do you intend to put in place to deal with these risks? Notice here that nowhere am I talking about the law. I'm not just focusing on the risks of the product, digital money, whatever digital asset or product that this is going to provide. Once we agree on how to identify the risks and how to manage the risks, we then have some kind of, I don't know what you call it, the service level agreement or some kind of agreement between the central bank and that entity that enables you to now monitor, because we now know what the risks are and what you're putting in place to manage those risks. Only then do you monitor. That agreement that we have with you, we then work back, and that forms either the principles. We will extract the principles of the tenants from that agreement, and that what constitutes either guidelines we issue, or a regulation, or perhaps even a law. So it's two steps forward and one step back. And this was the same approach when our GCC that we used with the mobile money. We didn't know it. But it looked like it had potential. So the issue was, let it start, but watch it. Now, with regards to the question, so one of the first things we've done is that putting in place a framework for a regulatory sandbox that would enable us to properly understand the risks associated with these digital products. The second one, and this is probably the hardest for us, the central bank, is to try and open our minds to the possibility that things can be done differently. The way they used to be. Economists, we have a fundamental problem. This is 2020, I'll still quote Adam Smith in 1774. Okay? We are almost linear in our thinking. But taking to us things from behavioral science, from psychology, from other fields, we begin to realize that, you know something, it's possible that there are different ways of doing the same thing. There are different ways of skinning a cat. You only just have to agree why you need to skin a cat. Okay? So, We have been deliberated from the Union Bank of Uganda. We actually created a working group with the Union Bank of Uganda, which interestingly, I think I'm the only senior person in the working group. The rest are all junior officers, people who are young and have a less prone to bias that comes with the age. Yeah. And they are supposed to help us come up with the with an internal strategy or policy on how we deal with these new technologies outside of those or the regulatory samples. So it's those two things that we bring to the central bank. The third one, of course, is talking to our peers. The other central banks that have done this, the other central banks that have advanced, China is probably going to be the first central bank in the world to issue a central bank digital issue currency. The Bank of Canada is looking at something. The Bank of England has a working paper on this. The Reserve Bank of South Africa has actually done a proof of concept on digital money. So we have the benefit of not having to reinvent the wheel. We look at what others have done. But bear in mind what solutions we need. So it's those four things, I believe, that will gladly, I believe, will help Bank of Uganda be able to deal with this new with this new technology and digital money. I think I've saved my butt. Yes, sorry about that. As like I said, I've saved my part. And from my discussion with Kwame, he says that this time we should be able to take a couple of questions from you, if you have any.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Twine. A round of applause to Dr. Twine.
First of all, buttress the fears of the official from the ministry. so long as I come before the 90s. But at the time of the decade, the century, in early 2000, when we had the first telephones coming between Uganda, we already saw like the imbalance of economic power. So at that time, it was telecommunications coming to this country. And I want to tell you about something to do with capital, foreign capital coming to, let me say, Africa. I want to tell you something about capital, the relation between the law and how it has capital. Now, just briefly, Uganda in regulation, we have already fallen behind. We are late. Remember when Airtel just came, the way they kind of did their business, I was so. If you read the newspapers at that time, the imbalance of the way Airtel was conducting its business wasn't as fair to the customer, and I'm talking about consumer rights here, this thing. The law, as a student, as I was reading, I think the law should kind of, in a way, try to protect even as black persons with the people in the third world country, Africa. When this globalization of capital, the way we have now, let me say, vintage and now what we have, the globalization of capital, I think the risk is even coming much more closely. I want to pose a question to the law practitioner that the law right now has behind minimally deals with few issues like regarding liquidity, ratios of these people who operate mobile money. Let me zero down on mobile money operator. For instance, when we ever address questions of regarding personal question, when this money, if I die and I have my money on the mobile money account, what happens in case of my death? Does this money refer to the operator? So I think we need to, the people who are the police, the people who are responsible for the police making and making the laws. If China is already provided, and the most early city, the poor is being kind of hesitant when we do our decisions to kind of start with China. Already the world power is already coming so fast to regulate and issue around all these things to localities. Then why the hesitation from the Ugandan government or the policy makers?
We're not fully aware about some of these risks. What we're asking you to do as a bank was a financial institution, is to hold extra capital. Now, for this is how it works in terms of incentives. It means that the shareholder who would like to put in as little money as possible and make as much as possible, by having to commit his or her funds to the institution, is more committed to its sustainability. And if the sustainability of the institution is tied around how it manages several risks, that's exactly what we're seeking. That's the kind of behavior we're seeking. Then there was the issue of digital money widening the gap between the haves and the have-nots. The gentleman who asked this question, if you could just put up your left hand and see how many of your fingers are equal. You see, the capitalist system that we live in rewards those with, rewards people for their different efforts. And we all have different capacities of effort levels. The role of government, which perhaps the Minister of Finance will talk about, is try and equalize it. But it does not mean that in the advancement of technology, if we're going to say technology should not move until everyone has parity in terms of income, or in terms of endowments, all you're doing is that one, you are slowing the inevitable, and two, you're possibly potentially driving some of that technology either out of this country or another. So, while yes, it is a consideration in terms of the gap, I think the key issue, like I said earlier on, and the lawyer here will talk about it, is we don't, as central bank, we decided that we cannot focus on laws and equality. I can always say that the central bank can issue one thing, that the risks associated with digital money or some of these technologies are kept to a bare minimum. How the different persons use this technology is basically a function of their capabilities. Okay? So I'm not shooting down the idea of narrowing the gap between the haves and have-nots. I think a better focus, and which is the position taken by the central bank, is that we shall always focus on the risks. Because once the risks have been eliminated, the ability of one to take advantage of the technology better than the other is a function purely of the efforts. Thank you.
Thank you. And in response to Mr. O'Neill's question, you raised a valid point around the fact that there's so many sectors that we can't just have one set of regulations, and that's true. But I think that first around the point you raised that a draftsman can't be expected to know about coding and therefore draft around it. That's also true. But I think this is the time now to have the discussion and say, we are changing our approach. So the person that's drafting a regulatory regime, the person that's having a conversation of policy, is not just a lawyer who went and did that would be applicable for the world in which we are going. And then around the fact that another consideration we should have is that maybe we need to take an innovative approach. Just like EPS said, is that if the central bank, for example, is saying that, we don't want to focus on the laws, maybe now is the time to say, instead of having a hard law written down, do this, don't do that, maybe it's time to take an innovative approach and say, let us come up with the principles. The principle around how do we protect trust. The principle around how do we try and ensure that cost is not manipulated. The principle around security. And then what then happens is that perhaps we can take an approach of saying, we'll have it as a comply or explain regime. You know what I mean? So that when we are looking at these technologies, even when the regulator is looking at them, we're saying, these are the principles we've highlighted, and you either comply with them or explain why you're not complying, because that then also allows the regulator to be able to be fluid in the positions they take as the technology changes. Maybe now's the time to take that different approach, as opposed to thinking about applying the laws as we thought about them, where a draftsman came up and it was approved and discussed in stone for that duration of time, and then technology is 3 years ahead of where it is, or 5 years ahead of where it is. I honestly think that it's possible that if we approach it from a more innovative angle, and say maybe let's take the approach of regulatory principles, you either comply or explain, it might serve us better, because like Ivanity said, there's so many different areas, we can't have a look for each of them that's prescriptive. Maybe now's the time. There was a question about mobile money, and if I caught the question correctly, it was around, you know, regulation for mobile money and how we protect people. And I think it's always difficult to have 100% protection. And I think your conversation probably links to the fact that there was recently in the press a conversation around 7 billion that's unclaimed. Who is it going to? Maybe some of this belongs to people who passed away and all that. And I don't know if you can ever have a law that solves every problem. You know what I mean? But I think that it's also possible for the regulators to say that in the way that we are handling these technologies, it's the parameters that are applied, because the basic needs of humanity are the same, that if I own something, I don't want it to be taken away. So if I own e-value, my mobile money, I want it taken away from me. If I pass away, I'd like it to pass to whoever, I'd like it to pass to, you know, my estate or whatever. So maybe rather than say that we write that into the law, the opportunity to have regulations provides a chance to have unnecessary guidelines, but your question was a bit complex. I don't know if I've answered it or if I have asked an even more complicated question.
All right, thank you so much. And then there was a question on risk. There was a question on risk, the biggest risk being cybersecurity. Do I have any comments?
Okay. As society digitizes, there will always be the percentage of society that wants to unfairly gain from the recognize of others. That is a human weakness. That's why we have prisons, police, and all these other things. So as society becomes more digital, crime is just going to go to cyberspace. And as crime goes to cyberspace, there's going to be a need for us to mitigate those risks. So yes, you're right, cybersecurity is the biggest risk because they are criminals. And because money is in the cyberspace. Right now, in the top 10 biggest companies in the world, 6 are tech companies. And by tech, I mean their product is digitally native. There's no physical product. That's what I mean. Facebook is a platform online. You know, Google is a platform online. So value is now on that value is online. And where value goes, so will the criminals go. So our challenge is to equally equip ourselves with the right people, with the right policies, and with the right technology to address cyber risk. Now the problem is that we think about these things later. When we are busy using Facebook, the last thing you're thinking about is putting all your personal identifiable information online that someone can impersonate you. If I look at your Facebook feed, I can impersonate you right now. And that's a risk. You might think you have nothing to hide, but you have access, you have networks, you have people who have access to money. If I can impersonate you, I can collect a couple of millions from your networks, and I move away. If I do that 1,000 times, that I'm already in the billions. You understand? So now we need to now start thinking about our digital presence differently. It is no longer a pastime. Maybe 2 decades ago, internet was a luxury, where it is a pastime. Now people work 100% of their time online. All their money is online. They get paid online. Their relationships are online. The statement I keep making is that the circle of trust in 2020 is not complete until I meet your digital self. I can meet you physically and we shake hands, but the first thing you will do after you leave here is check out my Twitter handle, look at my LinkedIn and my Facebook. That is when you have a completed trust. You understand? So our digital selves now have value, and the hackers are looking for that value. And so it's a cut and mouse game that is always going to be there. Technology is just taking us there, but that's the reality. So the same way we have police is the same way we need cybersecurity experts. And now the challenge in us is, are we bringing enough of them? Thank you.
Thank you so much. I'd like to, in the interest of protocol, I'd like to invite Dr. Twine to invite our Honorable Minister of State of Finance.
Thank you,
had a lot of the same students in the same district to give his remarks this evening. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. But first of all, I have some allergies to my eyes. The cow. If it was yellow, it would be good.
Supervisor, but when you wanted to introduce me, you went to the podium, he sat, and he was like,
So I will saturate this when I entered it because I was just dictating it from when I was coming. But I wanted to share with you, and I'm happy that you have invited me here at this time, because to me, I think that we are entering a decade of economic growth. That the decade, this decade between 2020 and 2030 is going to be the greatest expanded economy. Drivers. Before I talk about the digital economy, I want to give you a few drivers of what I think is going to be one of the key drivers of this economic boom in the next decade. Of course, one of it is peace and security. The second, it is within this decade. It's within this decade that we are going to have our oil and gas out of the ground. It's within this decade that we are going to do the SGR, that's the railway from Mombasa up to Kabale. It's within this decade that the iron ore is recovered. Remember the steel we have been now importing steel worth $369 billion. That we are going to start a factory in the Bupo, in the Kabale, and replace the steel that were being imported. We have also started the industrial parks. If you visit, and I hope Robert, you have some time to have people go to Kabale and see what is happening. Because as we speak now, these tiles which have been imported are now made in Kabale. They are now made in Kabale. We are no longer importing tiles from anywhere. It is in this decade that we are going to talk about issues of tourism, commercialization of agriculture. But I'm only today morning, I had a chat with one of the investors who is doing rice in the Brambuli. He's using the drones to plant rice. And I'm sure, Robert, if you have a visit to some of these places, people will understand what after we are talking about the economy. Even if you talk about the digital economy, you must understand what the economy that you are operating with. What economy are you trying to digitize? We are also focusing more, and within this decade, manufacturing. As we speak now, 1986, we had 184 factories. As we speak now, we have 4,900 factories. And this is just this is not theory or just a talk. You can use Namambe, you can use Kabeka, you can go to Mongolo and see factories. It is in this decade that you are going to, if you get that map of the roads, you can see some of the things that we are trying to do. Look at the national ICT backbone. In the next 3 months, we shall be borrowing the next draft, $400 million to do the last. Yes. To do the last mile of the ICT backbone. I know some people have issues to do with borrowing, isn't it? You have it. But I want to tell you how we finance our budget, including how you finance your own and personal budget. You can get money from taxes or grants, or if you don't want, you don't have the money from those two sources, then the next is to borrow. But as you borrow, the most important thing, there's no country in the world that is going to borrow. Even the strongest economy, US, is indebted in trillions from China. But the most important thing is that when you borrow this money, you should be able to implement the projects that you are borrowing for. You are talking about digitization of the economy. There's no way you can do digitization of the economy if you don't have internet across the country. So this is what we are going to be doing. And have you seen the
airports and the I really like to speak to students because they're very interesting. There is a time we were talking about Uganda here and people saying, oh, can it happen? When you brought the companions, I don't know what you talk about now. So, it's again in this ticket that we are going to finish. Or, as we speak now, we have over 20 roads for tarmacking across the country. As we speak now, you can move from Kabale to Kobombo for the tarmac road. And we are going to complete this
in the next 10 years.
The last point. Whether you like it or not, we can't run away from technology. I don't know at the back of Uganda have some views about this technology, especially the blockchain technology. From our perspective, we look at it as a driver for this economy. We look at it as a supporting instrument that can drive our economy, as an accelerator. Think about it. Before the mobile money, you would move miles and miles to go to the bank to get money, your own money. But as we speak now, you can send your children, your parents can send you money from deep in the village. You don't have to go to the bank, you use your mobile money. And that's why I want to go to the issue of taxing and all that, because when I benefit here, I got a different reaction. Now that I have many of the supporters like here, I don't have to go into that. So digital economy is an accelerator, an amplifier, it makes change, and something that we work on. And as I said, it refers to that part of the economy based on digital technologies and platforms. Global shift towards provision of goods and services via digital channels and platform, and this shift, we are experiencing it right now. And the trend is driven by innovation and technology. In terms of the financial sector and application, formerly financially included, good adults in Uganda increased from 28% in 2009 to 58% in 2018. Due to mobile money. We can see now the trend of so many people using mobile money than we were a few years ago. The other sophisticated and digital innovations which we have, and I think these people have talked about, we see that technology can actually help us in telemedicine. It is possible now we can help and leverage some of these apps, you know, to go to a clinic in your village, they test and you connect with somebody at Harvard or any other university. We have talked about, I'm sure I've talked about smart farming, artificial intelligence. The other time, Robert and Kwame organized a conference here, they brought somebody called Sophie. Sophia, very interesting human being. But when we say, are you interested in ruling the world? She said, of course I'm not a human being. So there's no way. So you can imagine what I'm being told that in China, robots are replacing human beings in serving in hotels. So you go to a hotel, press a button, and the robot will come and serve. So these things are coming. We have machine learning for robots, blockchain technologies. So we see this as an opportunity, not as a threat. They have talked about risks, but for me, I'm very optimistic. I'm an optimistic man. I don't concentrate more on the risks. I don't concentrate more on what will not work. I concentrate more on
back to work. If Facebook is going to have a, what is going to have? Facebook, I think Uganda was talking how can we now embrace this technology than concentrating on how it will not work. How will it affect the millions of Ugandans if Facebook now started cryptocurrency? This is what we should be, I think, debating. What I've seen, I've been a member of parliament now for 15 years. But the challenges we have with technology, this perspective of the faculty of law, is that this technology is changing. Today you make a legislation, technology changes, and as it changes, the law becomes irrelevant. So how can we together research and develop legislation that actually can stand the test of time in terms of technological changes? I think that's one of the things that looking for, especially from you young people. We would be, I don't know that really talked about the national payment system. You've not talked about the national payment system. We have now a bill in Parliament, which was started by the Bank of Uganda, the national payment system. We have been regulating mobile money, but not to the level that we want. For example, if you have balances, your account, mobile money account, there is no law that now regulates that. Most want to regulate if you have balances on your dormant accounts in the bank. We are proposing that these balances in platinum can be kept for the consolidated fund.
We formed a task force headed by Honorable Nasasa
and they are coming up to with a report on all the technologies with the fourth industrial revolution, including the blockchain, Internet of Things, and others. We hope that we'll be able to make some recommendations that we can adopt as government. I just thought I should come and share with you, but most importantly, listen from you. So I will be here to take any questions about the economy and Greece. Even if you feel like you have some anger you want to steam out, you are also welcome, as long as that doesn't turn out to be violent. Of course, you know what violence means. I have my lawyer here, Robert. He will stand for me. But I think it's important that we know that our economy is growing, that we are entering an important period where all of us should participate. It's going to be a decade of economic growth, like it happened in America in the 20s. And for it to happen, we have to maintain peace and security. For it to happen, we must have a tested leader. Leaders.
Experience with cryptocurrencies is that actually it's a good thing to run for us. just need to ensure that these cryptocurrencies play by the rules that govern money. One of the rules that governs money is that money has to be scarce. But then the problem with cryptocurrencies is that, you know, we can generate it with ease. You just need to engage in cloud mining. All you need is your PC or maybe your phone, an internet connection, then you just mine Bitcoin for free. So all of us know the threat that this can bring to our economy if we have to match that situation. Another issue is that, you know, cryptocurrencies are yet to be a unit of money. By unit of money, I mean that what if I want to buy a pen, I need to know that the pen is worth 500 shillings. But then with cryptocurrencies, you just have one coin, it's worth 8,500 USD, less than 30 million right now. And it's broken into Satoshi. Satoshi is smaller volume. So when I want to buy something in Bitcoin, it's discretionary. Just tell me that you pay 0.003 Satoshi. I need to know that, you know, we need to fracture these currencies in the way that we actually know, the public knows that this is the unit for this. Otherwise, actually, I have no problem with Bitcoin. It's a step in the right direction. Thank you.
And the lady, there's a lady down here. And then we'll take another round of comments. Let's start with this first round. Three questions.
Thank you. Good afternoon to everyone present. So I have noticed that there are quite a number of members of the National Task Force present today. And you've talked a lot about technology, compliance risks, all those things have been presented. And I understand Crypto Savannah was one of the companies that was put on trial in regards to the security risks that are being caused by especially cryptocurrency. So as the National Task Force, what are those exact regulations you've put in place to control such technologies? Because most of
risks and what are we doing about it? I think that's another important question.
we formed, as I told you, a task force headed by Honorable Jonas Husband, I think this is your kit. And we are waiting, we want to look at these all new technologies from a broader perspective and then see where the gaps, the laws that need to be made, where policies need to be made, and we hope we are still waiting for you. Once that comes out, we will be able to come up with some legislation that can actually protect and address these risks. But in the meantime, you talk about, as I hope Twino talked about, how are we regulating mobile money, how are we regulating the Bank of Uganda is that it is that about these cryptocurrencies. They are still traditional, and it's a debate that we are continuing to have with them. But I hope that after the report, they will be able to see what happens. But we have some measures that we are putting in place. When we pass the national payment system, which I encourage all of you to read, the one we talked about, government accounts and all that, something that we need to look at. The last one is these things that we're talking about, it's not diversionary, it's actually reality for now. When we talk about the road, it's not diverting, you need it. When we talk about electricity, you need it. In a few years ago, you are experiencing load shedding, but now at least temporarily we have excess energy. But remember, factories for energy. Energy does not fall factory. So what we put in place to these dams, the Karuma and Simba, so that we can generate a lot of electricity and the investors don't have to dump when they come. So that's why we have a temporary process. But the point I'm making is that they are not inviting people. We actually talk about various things. And at the same time, we need to address your issues, simple issues that affect the ordinary people. I'm affected as well, and we're addressing it. For example, now if you use an identity card, you have to move from up country and come to Kororo to get a replacement. We have discussed this at cabinet and directed the Minister of Internal Affairs to address this issue. People cannot move from up country to come to a replacement of a national card at the national level. We should be able to handle some of these things at the sub-county. Are we manipulating to benefit from elections? Fortunately, the NRA government has no record of manipulation. There is no evidence.
Of health
has treated for the question of supplementary of 25 million just for preparedness. If it comes, it's well. So let's not laugh about this. I will explain it empty. Let us take it seriously. Is that okay? Yes, thank you.
And I'm against of the panel. I observed the more you advise that you shouldn't make contact, the more contact they make. So you need to find the 25 billion to give the police of help. But having said that, I want to address myself to the issue of the right to privacy. Now, as you know, I don't know, I hope these are not students. The right to privacy is provided for in the Constitution under Article 27, excellent. Now, using that very article, as you know, the Constitution is very broad. So what we do as the executive or government and parliament, you pick those broad articles and break them down into laws. So we enacted, or parliament enacted, the Data Privacy and Protection Act 2019. Now in that act, it clearly stipulates the responsibilities of the data holder. So in other words, if data has your data, they have certain responsibilities that they must undertake to ensure that your data is not misused. For instance, you don't want people calling you because they have a product to sell, simply because they accessed your data from the data database. So those provisions under the law do exist. But what we are doing with that data the e-services is to integrate the systems in government, such that if you are applying to come to Makerere University, you voluntarily submit your name, and then Makerere can pick your data automatically from the database of NIDA. And what that means, you don't have to fill in all these elaborate forms, filling in the same information over and over again. The same shall be applied for driving licenses as well as passports. So where personal data is needed, you, the data holder, the owner of the data, would voluntarily put in your name and submit to the person who requires that data. In fact, we tend to extend it here to the banks, but please note, you yourself, the same way, how many of you have Gmail accounts or Google, Yahoo? How many? Everybody. But many of you, none of you has ever read the terms and conditions. Who has read all of them? None of us, including myself. Now what that means, that your data, as you talk about privacy, your data is held in California somewhere under Californian law, and you submit it voluntarily, and you didn't click that button that you confirm, isn't it? So you surrender your data. Mutua wansi. So that's the scenario. Those are the issues, you know. So you submit your data and basically get rid of it. Now on the task force, as the minister has explained, what is true in our sector, policy, regulation, and legislation normally come later. The technology comes, and technology comes very, very fast. 10 years ago, we were talking 2G. Then before we could settle on 2G, 3G came. Before we could organize ourselves, 4G came. We have to get settled. Before 4G, People are talking what? 5G. Now the implication is technology comes extremely fast, and then legislation follows, rule policies and regulations. Now in that context, indeed for us to understand, and that's why Bank of Uganda is cautious. They are saying first hold on as far as cryptocurrencies are concerned until the committee that government has put together to study these fourth industry revolution technologies can advise and then put a robust and appropriate policy environment for us to be able to utilize those emerging technologies. But what is true, the technologies are here, they are with us, and technology has no borders. Even as Bank of Uganda was insisting and telling people to go slow on cryptocurrencies, never mind the fact that there's a confusion between cryptocurrencies and Ponzi schemes, Ugandans, and actually some members of parliament, one of the other that your colleagues were part of this arrangement. You know? So people go ahead and use the technologies. Now, once the task force finishes all its work, they will advise government on what policy undertakings to take up, to pick up, and then create. If we need a law, then we shall put a law in place. If we need regulations, we shall work with the Attorney General's Chambers and put up regulations to basically ensure that Ugandans are protected. The last one, I'll just clear one issue before I hand over to Noah. Crypto Savannah has never been accused of anything. I had something like that. It was misinformation. The misinformation was that they had organized a conference on cryptocurrencies. That conference has never happened in Uganda. So it was basically misinformation. The conference that Crypto Savannah organized was the blockchain conference. And blockchain is a technology just like Microsoft is. Now, you can use Microsoft for fraudulent purposes. You can use it to type a letter, misleading, and you call people. Likewise, blockchain as a technology can also be used for the same purpose. The same way you get a call and we use your phone for the wrong purpose is the same with blockchain, or just like any other technology can be utilized for the wrong reasons. Thank you very much.
So I'll address the technical questions on cryptocurrencies, then of course Dr. Trina will look at the regulatory implications. Someone asked a question about the structure of cryptocurrencies, and the example you gave was actually Bitcoin. Now the challenge many people have with Bitcoin is that it's too valuable to be used daily. It is argued that Bitcoin is the modern day digital gold. Why is that? Because how many of you have tried buying Rolex with gold? It's okay. Why is it difficult? Because to get 2,000 shillings worth of gold, it's almost impossible to even handle. You understand? And that's the challenge that Bitcoin is facing, because it's too valuable. That's why it is used more as a representation of value. And all other cryptocurrencies below Bitcoin derive their value from looking at Bitcoin. So any movement Bitcoin makes, the others make it, because it's sort of like the cryptocurrency pay. It is the first and the oldest. But then we keep using Bitcoin as the example, but it's also wrong to use it that way, because there are very many different kinds of cryptocurrencies. Others have very specific use cases. Others are used particularly for credit purposes. Others are even more of a platform like Ethereum. Ethereum doesn't pride in itself because of being used like a currency. It is more as a platform to create other cryptocurrencies or other crypto assets for particular use cases. So even in the world of cryptocurrencies, there are different tokens, different currencies, different coins that pursue different purposes. And like there's mentioned, it is It's open source. Even you here can start to create your own. The misconception is that anyone can create a currency and it will be, and mint money. That is wrong. It is the equivalent of me tearing a piece of paper here, writing my name and calling it money. How many people will use that as money? No one. So why would they trust my issue? Why would they trust my currency? If I can't even get two people to trust it, then it will fall by the wayside. Where cryptocurrencies derive their value is from demand and supply. And as the PS has mentioned, human beings are by nature curious. And that is usually what drives the first wave of adoption. Then once that technology or innovation demonstrates value, it then gets mainstream adoption. Same story with Bitcoin. I can't mine Bitcoin right now, no matter how much I try with a laptop. The way the cryptocurrency has been designed is specifically for scarcity, the point you raised. That's why there is a finite amount of Bitcoins that will ever exist. And the closer we get to that amount, the more scarce it becomes. And because it becomes scarce, the price goes higher. So scarcity or deflation is wired into the core. And it's wired in such a way that anyone who tries to break it devalues whatever attempt they're trying to do. So it was quite an ingenious way of trying to capture and to embed certain economic principles within the money. And that's a thing that the technology has given us an opportunity to. Right now, traditional money needs rules to govern its use. We have been creating, we're now in a technology whereby the rules to govern money can be written within the money itself. This is why the governments are now seeing the benefits of cryptocurrencies, and now they're coming up with what they call CBDCs, as Dr. Greene had mentioned, centrally backed digital currencies, the first of which we're seeing China. Because what it does, it can allow for all the rules we create around money can be built within the money itself. So for you, I'll give you a domestic example. If you leave money at home to buy bread and milk, you come back hoping that money was used for the purpose you set it out for. But now we have a money that you can embed the use within the money itself. So if Honorable here decides and says, no, this year, 13 trillion will go to health, it is wired within the money itself. Meaning that if that money was tried, if someone tried to misappropriate that money, it would functionally not work. Because its rules of use are programmed within it. That is the opportunity that cryptocurrencies are presenting. And there are many, many other examples. So I hope I've addressed that whole thing of scarcity. The other issue was the regulations around crypto. I'll allow Dr. Trini to address that. But I think that most of you must be mindful for is that as much as we try to put new technologies into our old rules, what we are seeing now is that now there's a new opportunity to rewrite those old rules. Okay? Someone challenged the fractional reserve system. I don't know how well we're going to do with that, but now we have a technology that can embed sound economic practice within the financial structure. We have the opportunity to rewrite the very rules of, for example, what does it mean? What does privacy mean in 2020? Initially, it was about personal identifiable information. Do you know that if you're in a place and there's CCTV taking a picture of you, that is your personal identifiable information? A technology has come that is redefining what we call personal information. And so even as we try to get regulation in place to protect, you know, and to govern these risks, we must also understand that we as society are changing because of this technology. I've given an earlier example. The human body has evolved to a place where it cannot digest raw meat. But if we go back a couple of hundred years, we used to eat raw meat. So what happened? We invented fire that changed our biology. Human beings could walk hundreds of kilometers without a problem. But when we invented the wheel, now even two is hard. Understand? So these very technologies that we create change us as society. As I gave the earlier example of our social interactions. They used to be physical, now they are digital. Okay? Soon, our digital presence is going to now require legislation for identity. Right now, what this whole thing around KYC and AML is all around your digital identity. you have moved from your physical world. I can be in the best suit, you dress sharply, with a briefcase, with all my documents, walking to a bank, and they chase me away until they see my digital footprint. I've been there physically, but they only trust my digital self. As we move forward into technology, these things also change us as human beings. So we also must realize that, and as we question the rules that govern our social interactions, which are the laws, let's also realize that these technologies are also going to change that. Okay? And so, with that, I give over to you.
Thank you. The issue of unit of account or unit of value. You know, like I said earlier at the beginning, money has three attributes: unit of account, store of value, medium of exchange. The fundamental issue, at least from a central bank point of view, and that's why I say, when we try to define cryptocurrency, we try to understand it within the context of our understanding of money, they don't quite fit. Okay? And that's why you see what the gentleman was talking about is that for cryptocurrencies, because the price is extremely volatile, the valuation is volatile, it is not a good store of value. It doesn't mean it's bad, but it's not a good store of value. And that's why there is a speculative aspect to it. That's why I said earlier on, and I will repeat it here for the benefit of my minister here, is that Bank of Uganda's concern is not so much the benefits. Those are expected. And I think the minister laid out some of the benefits of some of these new technologies. The focus of Bank of Uganda is we need to understand the risks. And second, that those who are introducing these new technologies demonstrate that they have investment mechanisms to minimize the impact of those risks, both on the wider economy and on the individual members of the Ugandan public that will be using these technologies. That is the main focus. So the central bank. We are not going to do, as indicated earlier on, try to regulate technology. You can't regulate technology because it evolves, unless Parliament evolves a mechanism of revising laws every week. You can't regulate technology. However, you focus on the services and ensure that they're provided in a safe manner, that there's equity in treatment of persons for under the services, okay, and that the pricing is reasonable. That's how you regulate the services, not the technology. So there won't be any laws for technology. There can never be laws for technology. Bank of Uganda focuses on the risks of the technology. The benefits are known. No one contests. But until we understand the risks, because if tomorrow it was decided to roll out these currencies without a full assessment, the risk assessment, and someone gets cheated, whom do you turn to? You're going to say Bank of Uganda won't see. And that's why our position has been, if you must deal with these digital monies, until such time that we come up, if you must deal with them, you do so at your own risk. Because again, our focus is on risk. Not the benefits, not the gains, but the risk associated with it.
We are coming to the close of our session. So I'll just ask the last panelist in case you'd like to add your voice to the conversation.
Thank you, Kwame. And especially for making me skip 25 minutes to the end. And there isn't too much time for me to go on and on and on. But I think that what I can say in conclusion is really in line with what EBS and the rest of the panelists have said. Is that it's near impossible to say that you're going to have prescriptive laws around technology. The aspiration should really be to have the principles that you're looking for. And I think that it will become very important even as we think about how we have these principles on protecting people and transparency, data protection, etc. On saying that we must look at both the sophisticated person that understands technology and the person who's in the village, they are going to tell that cryptocurrency is a sound investment, they should pay their 5,000 every week, and still say that how best do we require protection for each of these individuals? How best do we protect our economy from fraudulent people trying to take advantage of the masses. And I think the last line that I can say is that at the end of the day, we have to accept the fact that there's always an element of risk. Even with traditional money, there's always been an element of risk. But it is that component of trust that is assigned to digital money by its very fiber that we should look to ensure that it's protected as we did through digital money.
Data.
we solve two problems in international trade law. Number one, rules of origin. Suddenly we are able to place the source of this Irish potato in a village in Swine. Number two, we are able to collect data from that prompt to say, this is the value of the Irish in that place, here is how long it takes to grow, this is the minerals it needs for the soil, and so on and so forth. Now we put the Irish on a better road, i.e. infrastructure, and we are able to track how long it takes to get the crop from the farm to the market. Because we are using artificial intelligence, we are now able to say, okay, why don't I sell the crop while it's still in transit and not wait for it to arrive in Kampala when it goes bad? That actually, for the 4 years who are here, is exactly how FOB and CIF work. CIF, in fact, is a contract instead of documents, is it not? It means that actually we can take what is done on the high seas and apply it on the world scale. Why? Because we have taken technology and embedded it in the process of growing the crop and bringing the crop to a market in Kampala. I have always argued that Kampala has one massive security flaw. It has only 5 roads that come to it. That's a massive security flaw because if you cut off Ginger Road, Masaka, Hoima, and Bulu Highways, and you stop food from crossing 3 kilometers into the city, Kampala will stop and you will have a massive political problem. It's also an advantage because we can harness data ports and collect them systemically and monetize and value that data. In China today, smartphones, a company is able to tell you whether or not I will remember my log by how long I take to read one screenshot. One has nothing to do with the other. You can't explain why. They just know that people who read faster are able to pay their own speaker. What does all of this have to do with me as a model? No. By the way, this is information that is now. What does all of this have to do with me as a lawyer? Let's say a human rights activist who is interested in solving the problem of the men who drink the money that their wives have spent a season counting it. You're now able to go to the courts and say, here is why we need to fire into flame the article in the Constitution on protecting the rights of women and their special place, matter and function in society. Subramani and Makwanyane were argued as human rights cases, and yet they made economic arguments. Simon is a human rights lawyer, he quoted those cases very, very times, he can tell us if I'm wrong. Also, as I'm writing a contract for the guy who is owning those trucks, I am able to value the price there differently, and therefore naturally define the risk in the contract differently, because now I have a new way to look at the services for this truck. As a transaction lawyer, the most valuable thing you will ever do, and I can tell you with some experience, is define the risk properly, because if you don't, your insurance policy is dead. What am I saying? I am saying that when I talk about insurance law, contract law, and we haven't even talked about all the other methods. By the way, when we go from mobile money to blockchain, what we are going to be able to do is to pay Maman Boba in the village of the blockchain without needing to come into a banking vault so as to be asked for a national ID and all of those things. Yes, there are people who either someone has wrong, someone who is developing blockchain for USSD. In other words, the technologies are bridging the gap between the complex and the people who are in the village and so on. However, in between society's friction sits the lawyer. We are sort of, if you think about a lawyer as the slave trade, in the slave trade context, the most profitable business during the slave trade wasn't selling Uganda to the UK, no. It was the person who knew the trade route, who sat at Mombasa and said, I know how to get to Uganda, and the men of Uganda are strong. Oh, in this case, the men of the land of the Chica are very strong. But I know three routes. One of them has a lion, another has a tiger, another is green. I can tell you if you pay. Businessmen know that Cecil Rhodes never owned a mine. He made more from the minerals and the mines of South Africa than anyone else. Why? Because he understood that you sell services to the miner, you sell water to a miner, you make more than the man from the world. The point being, we sit in the intersection of these technologies and society, but we must define the risks properly. I love that Catherine here, for instance, is writing on data privacy and the national ID system. What we then do is we take that research and we say to policymakers, have you seen these risks? And that's why our first pillar in the center is going to be robust, industry-based research. Danila is writing on Facebook and Cambridge Analytica and data governance. What's the difference between data protection that the BS has talked about and data governance? One is wider than the other. But we target that distinction and therefore be able to say, in addition to what the law is today, we should have the following certain instrument. Lawyers have to sit down and take the experiential understanding of Facebook and other platforms and apply those platforms to what is going to happen in the 2021 elections in Uganda. And so what we're trying to do is to say, look, let's take the experiences that technology is giving us today and infuse them with where the law is today and where it needs to go tomorrow. Thus, the idea of shaping the future of law. Many people will say, but can lawyers innovate? And in addition to brilliant minds, I'm very glad that my good friend Alex is here. Signal, the firm that he works with and that I'm privileged to know, has sponsored and built apps before. But you see, the best way to build an app is to ask yourself, what is society's biggest problem that I hate the most? One of the biggest names in tech in Silicon Valley is Peter Thiel. And Peter Thiel says, when he interviews a lawyer, when he interviews anyone, one of the questions he asks is, what's the one thing everyone will disagree with you about in 5 years' time? Why? Because it engenders you to think differently about the way society works. Peter Thiel is now backing a company that's going into private data and has collected swathes of data and so far as the biggest treasure trove of data, even bigger than Facebook. A company you've never heard of, and I know that Daniela is writing about it because I've seen her work. What we're trying to do therefore is to say bring policy, and I'm glad that the policymakers agreed to come today. Bring industry, and I was really hoping that some of our big friends would be here today, and bring regulation together, which is why we talk about money. There is no better regulation than we can. Bring all those three together and say, let's discuss the law in context. And let's discuss how to write laws in fact that make sense. People that I've done before, I saw Judith here, and she would tell you that I used to say in my first exorbitance in classes, I would open the lecture by saying, the first lecture by saying, I'm going to spend the next 3 weeks proving to you this act is poorly written. The problem with that act is because it was written by someone who did not practice insolvency even once. Why? Because when you come to private practice, Alex will tell you there is legal advice that is academic and there is legal advice that is practical. When you come here, we will tell you the first thing you do about that is go check up here. When you go to his office, the first thing he will tell you is take possession. Both of them are important parts of the process. But what do you do first? We have learned from practice that what you need in law schools today is to be able to teach lawyers how to think about satisfaction. So what do you hate the most about filing documents? One of the reasons why I have worked there for litigation, some say I'm a good litigator. The jury is still out of that. But I have walked away because I couldn't stand certain things like how long it takes to get a hearing date. What if there was an app that can solve that problem? Faith has solved the problem of I am in court and they shot me a video and I need a quick response and I don't have the time to go on Yuli and find the decision I need. So what has she done? She's gone to Yuli and said, instead of searching all of Yuli, just hit the tab that says family law. And in family law, just hit the tab that says divorce. And in divorce, hit the tab that says custody. And in custody, hit one that says children of gender. Yeah. In other words, she has simplified how much time it takes me to find the most recent decision and taken it from 3 days of research when we were in law school, there was no unified plan, to 3 minutes before a judge. Lawyers can innovate. I know that Alex has backed apps before. So what we want to do is, what if a student had a brilliant idea for an app that they can build? And then you told them, look, an app is owned by a company. You now bring company law alive. But you see, when we were setting up here, I told some people, someone came to me for advice and I said, what you're lacking is leverage. Don't do a deal without it. That's a thing I learned in practice. So I will tell you, but if you want to build an app and you don't have coding skills, what do? You go to computer science up the street and get a guy who can code. The second thing you need is incentive. What incentive do you give him? So set up a company and give them share. Now you must register your own company and then you go through the processes. Such that the law comes alive, it is law in action. That really is the goal of the center, and I'm going through all of that just to say that for those who have been asking, so how do I get involved? Where do you want to play? Do you want to understand?
what is the measure about? Because, by the way, the BS license, one of the things Kwame did not mention is that he is very involved in the World Economic Forum and that's something like that. So what we are looking forward to doing is leveraging these networks that we have to say, can we have global conversations with an African group? For the first time ever in 4IR, the world is at the starting line, as one of our friends likes to say. No one can say they figure it out. Not in any field of science. We can't contribute to the world a new legal design that factors in our risks as Africa and that is genuinely and truly unique. And that's what our goal is, to shape the future of law as we understand it today. I hope that you will pick some interest and you can go to the website, send us an email, let you know how you can improve. And again, from me and from everyone else, a very big thank you to our panelists. And lastly, but by no means least, my colleagues and I must have felt grateful to the audience. We did this for you. I know that some people still have questions. I'm sure the panelists still have a few minutes. So feel free to come and ask your questions and have a conversation. Until next month, when we have a conversation on AI. Thank you for coming. Oh, yes, by the way, the next event is on AI and labor, artificial intelligence. The biggest question in the future is, what is the biggest risk to disruption of jobs? We already have a job problem in Uganda, and we are saying, okay, what if AI comes, what will happen to even the few jobs that we have? That's the next conversation. The third one will be on the search for a new legal design. You know, I know that everything is on the website, but I mean, it will take different formats. The next one is the conversation for the dialogue, and the third one will be public venture. Give us a flavor of what the difference is. We have a judge of the Court of Appeals when we are going to give the lecture on legal design. I hope that you will still be interested by that. We wish you a wonderful weekend.